very much for coming. My name is Jess Burton, and I direct the Southern Maine Conservation Collaborative. We are a nonprofit in the city. We're based in the city. We work with 20 organizations to accelerate conservation in Southern Maine and develop strategic partnerships. And this is an example of a very strategic partnership with the Portland Public Library and the series of sustainability, the sustainability series. We're thrilled to be a part of the partnership to bring this conversation, touching on so many different aspects of our lives and our impact on the environment. We're thrilled to be here tonight, and I welcome you, and thank you for coming. And I'm going to just turn it over to Sam.
Hi, I'm Sam Duckworth. I work here for the library. I'm a science librarian, and one of our missions is to bring science literacy to everybody. So that includes opportunities like this to learn about important topics that touch our lives. It's especially relevant this month and next month because the Aeppli Council will be in town. Are you going to mention that at all?
Chris Powell.
Okay, so I won't get into that too much, but it's a very prestigious meeting of officials here in Portland that are from around the world talking about really high-level policy things. So it's cool that we get to learn a little bit about what's going on in the Arctic. And without further ado, I welcome Ben and Chris for the talk. So welcome.
Great. Thanks, Sam. Thanks, everyone. My name is Ben Twining, and Chris Aeppli is here, and you'll hear from him in 20 minutes or so. And we are both senior research scientists at Bigelow Laboratory for Ocean Sciences, which is in Booth Bay Harbor, or East Booth Bay, actually. And we're going to talk about research that we and others at Bigelow have been doing in the Arctic over the past couple years. And so we're going to focus on sort of two things. The first part I'm going to talk about is sort of the nutrient side of this, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what the impacts are of ice melting in the Arctic on sort of the natural processes, on productivity and nutrient cycling in the Arctic. And then Chris is going to come up and talk more about the human impact side and how that might change with a melting Arctic or a warming Arctic, and in particular some of the work that he's been doing on oil spills, or potential oil spills in the Arctic. So I think that I'm going to say, because we have a nice intimate crowd, that if you guys have questions, I think, you know, feel free to sort of stop us. The goal here is to communicate our science as clearly as possible, and if we say something that you don't understand, you have a question, just raise your hand and we'll make it a conversation, I think.
Before you go on, how do I find on YouTube?
So if you search for Bigelow Laboratory on YouTube, we have a channel, and actually there's full-length versions of both of these talks from this summer that you can see, but that would be the way. Yeah, there's a whole channel for us on YouTube. Good question. Okay, so before I get to the Arctic, I just want to give you a little plug for Bigelow Laboratory. Bigelow is a nonprofit research institution started in 1974. And our mission is to investigate the microbial drivers, of ocean processes. And so these are the plankton. These are the organisms that live in the ocean that are too small to see with the naked eye, for the most part. But they're incredibly important. So they make half of the oxygen you breathe. They're the base of the marine food web, and they take up a lot of the carbon dioxide that we emit. And so while they're small and hard to see, they're incredibly important, and they deserve a champion in the world. And so Bigelow is really one of the only institutions in the world that focuses on microbial oceanography. And I'll talk a little bit more about those organisms today, but this is sort of a picture. We've got these copepods. These are sort of the insects of the sea, and these single-celled algae called phytoplankton that many of us study. They come in lots of beautiful different forms. And there are millions of these in every teaspoon of seawater. And so that's what Bigelow does. We study these, most of us study these microbial organisms. Okay, so as I mentioned, we're gonna sort of divide this into two parts. I'm gonna talk a little bit about the Arctic, and then I'm gonna talk about impacts on productivity, mostly the productivity of those plankton. And then Chris is gonna come up and talk about human impacts. Nice and easy. All right, let's start with the basics. The Arctic versus the Antarctic. This is important, I think, because many people just think of these as the polar regions or the regions that are ice-covered. But there are some really important differences. And one of them, as my five-year-old knows, is that polar bears live in the Arctic and penguins live in the Antarctic. And that's the way it is. So that's one difference, but there's another difference as well. If you look, if we zoom into these beautiful satellite images a little bit more, there's Antarctica. And I think what's immediately obvious is that it is a continent that is surrounded by water, right? You've got an ice-covered landmass with very little of that landmass actually showing because it's covered in massive amounts of ice. And then you have this massive water body, the Southern Ocean, that isolates it from the rest of the continents. And so that's very different from the Arctic. In fact, it's sort of the opposite of the Arctic, right? Here's the North Pole, the Arctic Ocean, and you have basically an ice-covered ocean which is surrounded by landmass. And some people have referred to this as actually a Mediterranean, a polar Mediterranean Sea, because it's a sea in the middle of land. And in that way, it's very different. Not only do you have the people and the indigenous populations that live around the Arctic in those lands, but you also have things like nutrients and material that gets into the Arctic Ocean from the land. And that's something that I study and I'll talk a little more about. But in general, this ice is not sitting on top of land, it's sitting on top of the ocean. And so that's a big difference. So, point number one, difference between the Arctic and the Antarctic. Okay, so one of the things you've probably heard or may have heard is that the ice covering the Arctic Ocean is becoming less abundant. And I've got a couple slides to show you that. This is data collected by satellite. I downloaded this 2 days ago on September 26th. You can go in and get daily information on it. And this shows you, here's the North Pole, and you can see this is the current extent of ice, ice cover in the Arctic. And this orange line is the median, it's the average cover of the Arctic Ocean of ice for this day over the last 30 years or so. So you can tell, just looking at this snapshot, that there's significantly less cover than they've seen on average over the last 30 years. And this is a trend that has been going on for about a decade now, or more, which is a lessening of the coverage of the Arctic sea ice. And here's how that looks sort of over time. Here you've got the months from June to October. And here we're looking at the extent of ice cover in millions of square kilometers. And this is the area that has at least 15% sea ice, right? So they sort of make a cutoff of how much of the ice is covered, of the ocean is covered in ice. And here is the long-term average, again, that about 30-year average, 1981 to 2010. And you can see it's sort of relatively high. Of course, it peaks in the winter, and then it starts to melt in the summer. And the minimum is right around September. It was on September 10th this year, which is notable because it's my birthday. And then it starts to freeze up again, and you start ice cover to go up. So here's the long-term median, or long-term average. And then this light gray section is sort of two standard deviations, and that's an indication of how much variability there is around this average. But within two standard deviations, you have about 95% of all the variability. So this is sort of, most years are in this sort of envelope of time. And here is where 2016 is, the current year. So you can see that for much of the year and much of the summer, it's been significantly below not only the average, but below two standard deviations below the average. So it's a very low ice year. And in fact, it's the second lowest ice year after 2012, which is this green dashed line. So historically, 2012 has been the lowest ice year, and 2016 is now tied with 2007 for the second lowest. But all of the previous decadal are all sort of in this range. So we're definitely having a trend of lower ice cover. And if you look at it just about, now we'll take the September monthly average and look at it over time. So starting in 1978 and going up to almost current day, you can see there's just been this steady decline. Not steady, actually. It's been highly variable. But over time, there's a real trend of decreasing ice cover. So hopefully all of this sort of comes together to convince you that ice is becoming less abundant in the Arctic. Please. So this would take into account floating ice because these satellites are looking at any kind of ice cover. But my impression is icebergs are relatively rare in the Arctic. It's mostly sea ice. You have icebergs that come off of Greenland and the big ice sheets over Greenland, but I don't think very many of them make their way up into the Arctic Ocean. But it would. Okay, one other point I want to point out about sea ice and sea ice thickness is that not only is it becoming the coverage is becoming less, it's becoming sparser coverage, but it's also becoming younger. So more of the ice that is found in the Arctic is now single year ice, or new ice that's formed every year. And so I'm going to show a little movie here that's just going to flip through an annual image from 1981 up through 2007. And what this shows here again is the Arctic. Here's Greenland, Canada, and Alaska. And the colors show the age of the ice. So red is ice that's more than 5 years old. It's been around for a long time. Going down to dark blue, which is single year ice, and light blue, which is open water. And so what you'll see, there we go, is that we're starting to slowly click forward, 1984, 85, 86. And so you can see the sort of the contraction and expansion of the ice seasonally, but you can also see that this red and yellow and green ice, it's basically getting a lesser and lesser extent. There's less multi-year ice in the summer. And it's also getting sort of compressed in the Canadian Arctic, and more of this is becoming free. So by the time we get to 2007, it's really just along the coast in the Beaufort Sea where you're getting this multi-year ice. And so that's important because these types of ice behave differently. There's different organisms that live in the multi-year ice. It has different stability and also a different ability to cap the water from the atmosphere above it. And so there's another big trend, which is basically the getting younger of the ice. Okay. So what are the implications of this melting ice? Well, one of them is physical, and that is that it changes the heat balance of the Arctic. So when you have ice that's snow-covered and the sun hits the ice, 90% of it reflects off and just goes back into space. And that reflectivity we call albedo, and it's basically, the amount of solar radiation that's reflected off of the ice. So only about 10% of it would actually be absorbed by the water. Now, if you have bare ice, if that snow is melted or never came, it actually is significantly different. In that case, about 50% of it, 0.5 is a fraction, of that solar radiation is reflected, and the rest is absorbed. And so in that case, you're going to get much more warming of the Arctic when you don't have snow around. But if you go to an open ocean, where you don't have any ice cover at all, then suddenly less than 10%, in this case, they're averaging about 6% of the radiation is reflected back, and more than 90% of it is absorbed. And so this is something that scientists call positive feedback, which is the idea that as ice melts, you tend to have more absorption of heat by the Arctic Ocean, and that may cause it to warm more. So one of the concerns is that there's maybe a tipping point, and after you have a certain amount of ice that's not present, you can have more and more warming in the Arctic. So this is one concern about a melted Arctic Ocean. There's also going to be impacts on biology. So one way to think about this is this cartoon that talks about sort of the seasonal trend of productivity from winter to spring and summer. So over here on the left, we have sort of the dark winter, right? In the polar regions, there's no light at the depth of winter. And here you've got ice and snow covering the water, very little light. And basically, there's not much biology going on underneath the water because there's little light. And it's what we call net heterotrophic, meaning that there's like more animals than plants, is one way to think about it. There's nothing creating oxygen. And then as the year progresses, and as the sun starts to rise, you get a time point when there's suddenly enough solar radiation to support the growth of plants. And so you can see sort of the green coming, and that productivity happens first at the bottom of the ice as opposed to in the water below it. And that's because there's more light in the bottom of the ice because the light is coming from above. So the nutrients from the seawater are used by algae, and they grow in the bottom of the ice. They create a big bloom. And then organisms come like copepods and krill and things that are going to eat that algae, and they eat it, and then they tend to poop a lot, and they tend to sink that carbon and that productivity down to the bottom of the ocean, where it supports a whole ecosystem of things that live on the bottom, mussels, and clams, and other things like that. And so you sort of have this system, and then also at this point, the ice is melting as it's getting warmer, and you tend to have just melt ponds and then ice-free waters, and that lets the light get in, and you then actually can have blooms down in the water. And so you have this very productive time of the year where you have very strongly autotrophic, not heterotrophic, system. You've got a lot of productivity and production of biomass. So that's how it sort of works in the Arctic. You have a very strong seasonal signal. So what's going to change with melting ice? Well, one thing that's going to change is the timing of that big bloom. So in the top panel here, it's a similar plot where we've sort of time is along the x-axis. And this is sort of what we have now. We've got this dark winter. You've got the sun starting to come up in April and May. You have this bloom of that algae at the bottom of the ice in late May. And then it breaks up and you get big bloom in the water column in June and July. And then as the sun goes down and you run out of nutrients, you tend to have this red period, which is when all of the phytoplankton is getting eaten by bigger organisms and bacteria, and it becomes net heterotrophic, and then you tend to have ice coming up again, and it goes back to its dark phase. So you can see that that gets shifted forward about maybe a month or two, depending on how much warming there is, because there's a lot less ice. Suddenly the ice is melting around April instead of June. And so that will become earlier. It may become more intense. You actually may get more productivity, depending on what the nutrients do. So you can see it's a little more green, and these green arrows are a little thicker than up here. But the timing of that may affect the bigger organisms. So right, these plankton serve as the food for whales and for fish and for other large species that people eat and use for subsistence. And the timing of that may not match. Their food may suddenly not be available at the same time as the organisms that eat that food. So that's another potential impact that is of concern. All right, but phytoplankton need more than light. So I'm focused mostly on light. And in order to demonstrate that, I've put up this Mai Tai. It is 5:50, appropriate time for cocktail hour. And this is an example of what phytoplankton needs. All right, so in addition to needing sunlight to have a good drink, you also need nutrients. Without nutrients, plants can't grow. And most of the nutrients in the ocean are in the bottom of the ocean. And that's because they tend to be used up in the surface, and then those plants that took them up tend to sink down and be remineralized. They get turned back into dissolved forms, and they reside down there. So in order to support more growth in the top of the ocean, you need to mix those nutrients up. So you need to mix your drink. And it turns out that that's hard to do because of the density gradients in the ocean. When you have a lot of ice up here, you may notice that your drink can get sort of watery, right? Because your ice is melting, and that makes it harder for these nutrients at the bottom to mix up. It's a perfect analogy, the cocktail. And this is sort of what it is. You've got your phytoplankton at the surface. I guess here it's our lime. And then we've got our nutrient-rich waters down there. And in order for them to grow, they need to be able to mix into that surface water, which is hard to do with all that else melting ice, which makes fresh water. Okay. So let's now think about two kinds of nutrients. One of them are what we call macronutrients. And these are things like nitrogen and phosphorus and silicon. And these are the things that form the major building blocks of biology and of life in the ocean. So if you want to fertilize your lawn, you tend to add fertilizer, and you shouldn't do that in excess, I will say, because we've got sustainability people here and I want to be super environmentally conscious. But if you did do that, you'd add a fertilizer that contains nitrogen and phosphorus. Those are your macronutrients. And those are also the things that limit the productivity of the ocean in general. So this map shows the concentration of nitrate. This is the nitrogen, the primary nitrogen-containing nutrient in the ocean that can limit productivity. And the color scheme shows the concentration of nitrate, going from very low as purple and then red as very rich. And what you can see, this is, what depth is this? About 1,000 meters. So this is deep in the ocean. You can see that deep in the Atlantic Ocean, here we are in Maine, and deep in the Atlantic, there's not very much nitrate relative to deep in the Pacific. So there's a lot more nitrogen nutrients over in the Pacific than in the Atlantic. And this is because of the way the water flows around the world. It's a different lecture, I won't talk about that. But I point it out because the Arctic Ocean, which is way up here, a little too tall for me, you can see that one of the places that the Arctic Ocean touches the rest of the world is the Pacific Ocean right here, where it's really high nitrate. And the other place is in the North Atlantic, where there's relatively low nitrate. And so one of the things that affects the productivity of the Arctic is how much water gets into the Arctic from the Pacific versus the Atlantic. I know that's a lot of oceanography to throw at you, but that it matters for productivity. And another thing you can see, this is now looking, turn your head sideways, this is looking south to north along the Pacific Ocean, and this is looking down to 6,000 meters in the bottom of the ocean. So what's that? Almost more than 3 miles. And so here's 60 degrees south, down near Antarctica. Here's 60 degrees north. And you can see that as you go to the north, you get higher concentrations of nitrate. And here is the Bering Strait. So there's this little shallow sort of shelf that the Pacific water has to get over to then get into the Arctic Ocean. And it shows you this dramatic gradient between Pacific, rich Pacific water and the relatively nutrient-poor Arctic water. And that's because of all of this productivity, which is off of the Alaskan shelf, which is using up this nitrate. So this is sort of, I think of this as like, you know, the deadliest catch. You've probably seen that on TV. The very rich crab fishery in the Gulf of Alaska. That's sort of up here. That's like, this is the deadliest catch sink of nutrients. We're all getting caught here. But this affects how much nutrients get into the Arctic Ocean. And there's another kind of nutrients that phytoplankton need as well. They need what we call micronutrients. And so my analogy here is to fruity pebbles. I have young children again, fruity pebbles they've just discovered. Turns out that they like them. But they will point out that even fruity pebbles have some good aspects. Here's the nutrition label from fruity pebbles. And you can see that in addition to containing 10% of your saturated fat and 240 calories, and lots of other probably not so great things, like 15% of your sodium, they also contain some things you really need. These are your vitamins and minerals. So a serving of fruity pebbles contains 20% of your daily iron. So if you don't get enough iron, you become anemic, right? Your red blood cells don't work as well as they should. And the fruity pebbles also contain zinc, 20% of your zinc, that's good. Good for your skin and your hair. It contains copper, and it contains vitamin B12. And these are all examples of compounds that use metals. So to be a healthy human, you need a bunch of different metals to grow. Vitamin B12 contains mostly cobalt. And just like humans, phytoplankton need these same metals to grow. And so micronutrients are the metals that are nutrients for phytoplankton. And that's what I study. So for the sort of second part of my, or the last part of my talk before Chris comes up, I want to talk about or just show some pictures from a cruise that we went on, or people in my group went on last year, to the North Pole to study the concentrations of these nutrients, these micronutrients like iron, up in the Arctic Ocean. And this is sort of to give you a flavor of what it's like to do research in the Arctic. So this was a cruise that happened last summer, about a year ago right now, went from August to October, and it went at that time of year because that's the ice minimum, right? That's the time of year when there's the least amount of ice on average. And the goal was to get up to the North Pole. So there had not been a US surface ship that had made it to the North Pole unaccompanied ever. And so this was sort of a historic mission. And the ship left out of Dutch Harbor, which is, I think, also the deadliest catch place. And they went north, up into the Bering Sea, through the strait, up into the Chukchi. I guess they went this way first. They went up straight first to the North Pole. They made it to the North Pole and then came back through the Chukchi Sea and over the shelf and back to Dutch Harbor. So it took about 2 months, and it was on a boat. I have a picture of the boat. It was on a boat called the Healy, which is the only fully capable icebreaker that the U.S. Maintains currently in the Arctic. It's about 420 feet long. And I've got some pictures here just to give you a flavor of what it's like to do this research. So this is part of a program called GeoTraces, which has been an international program to measure metals in the oceans, including the Arctic Ocean. And here's an example of sort of some of the measures you have to take in order to measure something like iron in a pristine environment without contaminating it with your own body or with your ship. So one of the things, if you want to collect examples of sea ice or snow on the ice, and you don't want to contaminate them with the ship's exhaust, is you have to go far away from the ship. So the ship would get into an ice, they would put the researchers down on the snow, and they'd have to carry their stuff usually about half a mile away from the ship in order to take their samples. So there they're going with their plastic bag covered materials. Here we've got some researchers who have been actually put onto an ice floe. So here's a piece of that sea ice. And they're collecting ice with their ace hardware 5-gallon bucket. So here we were specifically looking for the algae that live on the bottom of the ice. And so you can see it's a little bit of that greenish color. And so they had been put down in this ice floe to try to collect it with a bucket. So you can, it's sort of a combination of like super high-tech sampling and super low-tech sampling. Here's someone trying to collect an ice sample, or excuse me, a snow sample for metal analysis. You can see that not only are they wearing warm gear, but they're wearing a Tyvek clean suit over their warm gear. They've got this very expensive Teflon shovel. Can't get that at Ace True Value hardware store. That's been cleaned so that they're not introducing any contamination. They're collecting snow and putting it in a bag to bring back and melt and do analysis on. So all of this was about trying to figure out how much iron is in the Arctic Ocean so we can see how likely algae are to be limited by iron. Here's an effort at taking ice cores. So we also wanted to study the ice, both the single year and the multi-year ice. And so here you've got a drill and a system for coring that ice. Again, this is an all Teflon, all plastic system with some titanium to give it rigidity. And they're drilling down, again, wearing suits and trying not to contaminate the sample with their dusty human bodies. And that's what an ice core looks like after it's been drilled. So it's, you can see it's about a meter and a half long, 3 or 4 feet long, and it's all wrapped in basically a big Ziploc bag to keep it uncontaminated, and they're heading back to the ship with the scientific booty. And once we get those ice cores back to the ship, we would cut them up into layers of different parts to see how much iron and other metals was in the surface of the ice versus the part in contact with the seawater. So we build these clean labs that are covered in plastic and with a filtered air. We'd put them in these very clean plastic trays and basically chop them up. So basically cut them into pieces. And then we take these slices of the ice and melt them and collect the phytoplankton that live within them. There's another example of that. And this is what you actually get. So although those look fairly clean, when you concentrate the algae onto a filter, these are both samples of phytoplankton that were collected from the bottom of ice. And this dark green is something called Melocyra. I'll show you a picture of it and another picture in a second. And it's a diatom, so it's a single-celled plant that creates these very long chains that hang down from the ice. And this is what those animals are eating on the bottom of the ice, is this sort of green, goopy phytoplankton. And then what we would do in our group, this is a technician who works for me, Sarah Rauschenberg. She was on the cruise. And we would take them and we'd look at them under a microscope. So these are the individual cells. Each of those cells is about the width of a human hair. And you can see some of them have a lot of color in them. That's the plant pigment chlorophyll. And you can see some of them are pretty empty. They're just sort of these empty glass shells. And unfortunately, we were there at the end of the bloom. We were there in September because it was the ice minimum. But a lot of the algae weren't very happy. They were very low in iron, and I think they were sort of starving at the end of the year. We're still working up and looking at the data. And what we do with these is we actually then scan the cells and determine what they're made of. So these are maps of the elements as they're distributed in these cells. So here's a string of cells, and this is silicon, which is part of the glass shell. And then there are these other elements, phosphorus and sulfur and iron and copper and zinc, that make up the molecules within the cell. And what we're doing, our role, is to measure how much of these nutrients have been taken up by the cells. And so we go to a facility in Illinois and we make these measurements, and we can pick up individual cells and actually measure their content. So it goes from a remote collection in the North Pole, we bring them back to Maine, and then we take them out to Illinois. And all of this is to understand how much iron they need. Yep. Okay, 2 more slides, just to sort of highlight the sort of historic nature of this. This is a nice group picture at the top of the North Pole. This is the Healy. Again, the whole crew, there's about 50 scientists, about 130 Coast Guard crew. And as I mentioned, this was the first time a U.S. ship had made it, a surface ship had made it to the North Pole unaccompanied. So we've had nuclear submarines there, but not U.S. surface ships. You can tell us the North Pole because we're at the North Pole with a little pole, and there's Santa, so you know you're in the right place. And then there's a little bit of a ceremony, just sort of commemorating that with some Coast Guard military pomp and circumstance as is appropriate. So we had a handing off of some, here's the scientists doing our best to stand at attention and behave appropriately. And you got to meet Santa. So yeah, so that's a little bit of a background and a little bit of a flavor about how the Arctic is changing, how the ice melt might affect biological productivity, and then a little flavor of how we go about studying those natural processes. So now I'm going to hand it over to Chris. Chris is going to talk about human impacts and how those might change with the changing Arctic, and how it might respond. Oh, and you need this, don't you? All right.
Let me try to switch this over here. Can you hear me okay? That's okay. Excellent. So we have this changing Arctic, and now Ben showed really nicely how all these natural systems are going to change. What I want to focus on this last part of this presentation is not just what is the effect, the kind of like direct effect of climate change in terms of phytoplankton changing, etc., but what is the indirect effect of climate change? So you saw how the ice extent changes rapidly and shrinks. That also leads to more human activity. So humans think, okay, this is some great opportunities we have here. All of the sun, for example, the oil that is stored in the Arctic is more accessible. So there is a possibility that we could explore these resources. All of the sun, you have less ice. People start thinking of, we could actually use the Arctic for shipping. What you see here is some shipping routes that go either along the coast of Russia or along the US-Canada region here that would connect, for example, Asia and Europe or Asia and the US on a much shorter kind of like scale than when you use the traditional shipping routes. The traditional shipping routes would go through the Suez Canal or through the Panama Canal. So you could save some time and fuel if you use this one here. So, and they are already, some ships are using these shipping routes. I have to say it's way, way less than the other shipping routes, but people start thinking if the ice continues to melt and all of a sudden we have an ice-free summer in the Arctic, maybe the shipping routes will be much more heavily used. And this isn't just for transport of goods, it's also for tourism, which is another potential that can increase a lot. And this ship here, this is the Crystal Serenity. This is a ship that just passed the Northwest Passage this summer. So just about a couple months ago, it started off from Alaska, went through this Northwest Passage along the US coast and then the Canadian coast, and and then came down towards us. And actually the first port in the US it stopped by was Bar Harbor. So they stopped there to Bar Harbor. And the remarkable thing about this is the first time that such a luxury cruise ship makes this Northwest Passage. And this is possible because there is less ice. This carried about 1,700 people on board. So this is much more people out there to think about what would happen if you have an accident of ships there and you have to do a search and rescue operation for 1,700 people. That would pose some logistic challenges. But also, you can think about the environmental challenge. What happens if a ship goes aground and there is an oil spill? This one picture here is the Exxon Valdez spill more than 25 years ago. It's in the sub-Arctic, so not in the Arctic. You can see this was a single tanker that got aground, and this whole oil slick oiled the whole coastline of the Gulf of Alaska with some really detrimental effect for the environment. So what we have now is this opening Arctic that poses some opportunities for humans, for economy, for the indigenous people there, but also some risks. And the question is now, how do we handle this? Like, how do we assess what we should do and what we should not do? And we think that science is really necessary to evaluate this opportunities and risk and come up with some clear idea. If we do this, then this happens. And this is what really fascinates me about science, is to use our science to try to solve problems and try to come up with prediction and recommendation for this. And at Bigelow, we recently just created a center for, we call it for Center for Venture Research for the Opening Arctic Oceans. And what we said is, traditionally, science has a little bit of a tendency of just staying within the science area. And with this rapidly changing Arctic especially, we feel it's much more of a need that the science engages more and more with the needs, with like asking local population, asking politicians, asking the public, what do we need, and be much closer to the needs there and find support to do this science. So at Bigelow, we do a little experiment to see how can we translate our science more rapidly so we can come up with good science-based solutions and inform policymakers and raise public awareness. What I want to talk about now is specifically what is the risk of oil spills in the Arctic, and more specifically, what happens if there is an oil spill in the Arctic. So you can always say, you shouldn't have an oil spill in the Arctic, but if one happens, then you need to know how this oil is going to behave. And as you can imagine, an oil spill in the Arctic is very different than an oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico, because the main reason because it's different is because you have ice. And this is a little illustration what would happen if you have oil in the Arctic. You can have an oil slick, then this can interact with the ice, it could kind of like be trapped in the ice, it could be trapped within snow ice slush. It could potentially migrate through the ice and form some pools. It could be absorbed by snow. If you have a deep sea oil spill that comes down from the bottom, this could come all the way up and then accumulate at the bottom of the ice. So you see there's it's just way more of a complex system if you have oil in the Arctic. Besides this, the ecosystem is very, very vulnerable there. So in a project that we did fieldwork last year, we were interested in specifically how do the microbes react to this oil. So the question we wanted to answer is, if we have this oil spill in Arctic environment, do the microbes, the bacteria, the phytoplankton react very differently than in a warmer environment? And also, where does the oil end up? And I now want to just show you a few pictures of how we did field work. And this was a project, this was actually funded by oil and gas producers. So oil and gas producers came together and said, can you investigate this for us? And we went up to Svalbard, which is an island of Norway, and made some artificial oil spill in a fjord. So we contained everything and investigated how oil behaves. And when you come up there, you have a lot of polar bears. So whenever you do some research, you need to have a polar bear guard. The method of transportation is scooters, and you're very close to the North Pole. The other thing about transportation, you need to have airplanes to go places. And we ended up in a little lab container in a beautiful fjord that was all frozen. And this is how our lab looked like. So everything looks a little bit makeshift. And this is the setup where we ended up putting the oil in. So this was this plastic bag that is floating. And this we put out on a fjord out here. This was deployed in February, so it was all dark. And this is how it looked after installation. Then February, March, April, slowly the lights get in, and you now see here all these installations that come up. We then went back there every month to take ice core samples, to look at where is the oil now and how do the bacteria, that was the project we specifically did, how the bacteria reacts to this oil. This is how you can see, Ben already showed how they took oil pores. We were not so worried about metal contamination, we were interested in the organics, so it was a little bit easier to do. But basically, coming there every month, taking pores, putting it in a tin, slicing them, afterwards melting them. We didn't do it very metal clean, and this is how an ice core looked like. And to analyze it, we melted it, because this is how you then can work with it, and we melted it in these little bags. And you can see, depending on the depth you had this oil layers that were in this ice core. We then made some experiments to see, even at this very cold water, so this is below freezing temperature, this water, this is minus 1.8 Celsius approximately, can bacteria exist there and actually degrade this oil? So yeah, this is just to give you a little impression how this is, and just for my experience, this is like it's a beautiful, beautiful area out there, and it's, I was there in May and then back there in June, and it was 24 hours light by the time I came there the second time, and it's really a nice and a pristine environment there. So I want to, we're just wrapping up this project now, but I want to tell you a little bit what we learned so far. So what we can see is if you have an oil spill and then it gets into the ice, there is an oil layer that forms in the ice that stays pretty much the whole year at the same place. So this here is the ice core, this will be the bottom, and this will be the snow on top, and this is where the oil layer is. So when we put in this oil and then weigh it, this layer, oil floats on water, so it stayed there, and then you have ice growing during the season, on the same time you have snow coming from the top, so this oil basically stayed there. But the second thing we saw is that also throughout the ice, so here the outer cordis is just kind of like oil that was contaminated on the surface by the coring. Once you shave off this, you see the lower part looks pretty clear. But when you then go in the lab and do analysis and then look at the kind of like specific oil compounds, you still can find some compounds that actually manage to migrate all the way through the ice core. But if you look at the total mass of oil after a whole season when the ice melts again, we could still see that most of the oil is still present. So what happens, this one here are now these mesocosms that were then recovered after a season, after the ice melted again, and it was about August when they were recovered. And in all of them, you still can see like a lot of oil still being present. So what happens in the winter is you basically freeze this oil layer, and then you have some oil compounds of oil can diffuse through the water, but the bulk of the oil still stays here. So if you have an oil spill at the end, when the oil melts, when the snow melts, you have to clean it up at this point. And what was pretty interesting from my point of view, I investigate a lot of bioregulation of oil, and I did a lot of work in the Gulf of Mexico to look at how bacteria degrade oil there. And there it's beautiful, warm, it's good conditions, so it's not really surprising that there is actually little bugs that can eat oil. After all, oil is just plant material that's really old. But even in the Arctic, even in these ice cores that were really cold and old seawater temperature, you had bacteria that seemed to be pretty effective in degrading oil. The only thing is that because there is such a big oil layer, they just didn't manage to degrade all this oil within a season. So a little bit of schematic how this looks like. You have, in the ice season, you have ice and seawater and the oil layer, and then this ice is actually not just solid ice like you have it in your freezer, but because it's sea ice, that means you also have salt there. And because there is salt, you when an ice melts, it creates these little brine channels which have really a lot of salt in it. So this is why in wintertime, if you put salt out, then the water melts. So you have this little brine channel that go down all the way through the ice. So through this, you can have a transport of some oil compounds that actually goes all the way in the water. But in this ice, there seems to be a really fascinating active microbial life that can actually use this oil and transform it. But then at the end of the season, you're still going to have your oil slick there. So to end this presentation, I just want to mention that we are really interested in translating science like this, or results like this, and not just writing our scientific paper and publishing it and say that's it, but communicating the science to the public is really a big mission of us. And what I want to make you aware of is that currently we have this Arctic Council meeting going on in Portland. This is a picture of an Arctic ministerial meeting 2 years ago in Canada. You see John Kerry right there. And what the Arctic Council is, this is a UN organization, intergovernmental organization, that manages, talks about Arctic issues. So members of this are all the Arctic states. You see the flag back there. But also the representative of the indigenous people, you see their flags down here, are present there. So they sit at the table with the minister of the Arctic nations and have a say how their land should be managed and what should happen there. Next week, starting from Monday, there are the senior Arctic officials, which are ambassadors and politicians and ministers from all these countries, are going to come together in Portland and have a three-day meeting to discuss issues. We had also some working groups of this Arctic Council coming in Portland already 2 weeks ago. There was the working group that's called the Protection of the Marine Environment. Marine Arctic Environment was here in Portland, and they discussed issues about shipping or invasive species or things like creating marine protected areas here. So a lot of these meetings are just closed, but I want to make you aware of one opportunity that there is. So on Monday, a lot of institutions around Maine are organizing a conference that's a full day, that's October 3rd, from the morning to the afternoon, where there's going to be a lot of panel discussions about all this changing in the Arctic from different perspectives. And on maineandthearctic.com, you can see a lot of events and see whether they are publicly open and whether you have to register or not. I think for this event, you have to register until tomorrow. So with this, I want to just end this and say thanks and open to questions and discussion. Yes?
When you use biological degradation like bacteria, how do you introduce them into your body?
So kind of the question, how does this work? Like, how do you introduce something that degrades oil? How do you introduce the biology? So if you, how do you control the spill, or how do you control the
bacteria?
The bacteria. So this is the interesting thing. Bacteria are like all over the world, and bacteria that can degrade oil are also in all the oceans. So oil is kind of like old plant materials, and bacteria, they just learn to eat whatever is available. And because a lot of oily material is present in the environment, they just evolve to be able to use oil to make a living. Of course, usually if you don't have a lot of oil around, then they don't have this enzymes that degrade this oil are not that active. But as soon as you put in oil, then they start to produce all these enzymes and they upregulate everything. So and degrade oil very rapidly. For example, also in the Gulf of Mexico, it is still there. It was studied very extensively. It just took a couple days until this bacteria started growing and then degrading this oil.
Yes.
So I'd say because oil is a natural material, there are like everywhere on the world you can find bacteria that can degrade oil.
Sure. You've now put your bacteria in and it's eating up the oil slick. How do I stop it from infecting my ship and eating my bunker fuel?
Yeah, so this is the other thing with how fast do they eat the oil. As you saw in this experiment, for example, we put just a little oil there, and still after a season, you still can recover a lot of these oils. So while they can be efficient at degrading oil, it's really not that much that they really degrade. If you have a big slick there, it takes a long time. Or if you oil a shoreline, this is going to stay there a long time. Like, you still now can find oil residues from the Exxon Valdez oil spill, if you look at the right spot. It's not a lot, but there are some pockets where oil is still there, although it was in the environment. Yeah. And the point about infecting, we always think of bacteria as being bad, but in the environment, like bacteria or even viruses, they have like a really important function, and they're just a natural, healthy ecosystem has all this assemblage of bacteria and phytoplankton and zooplankton that works together. Yes?
It's like a two-part question. The experiment for the oil in the ice, was it all Bigelow staff who worked on that, or was it multiple? And what was the cleanup like for it? Was it a tough process to get that all out?
Yeah, that's a good question. So first of all, question, what was our partners? So we, in most of the research projects we do, we work with a lot of partners together. So the science community is very collaborative. So also in this project there, we work with institutes from Norway, from France, from Canada. We work about 6-7 different institutes. Denmark was another one there. And this makes research also very interesting. In every project, you meet new people and you can see like how you can put your like skills together in a good way to answer all the different aspects of the project. Your question about cleanup, it was about 20 liters of oil per mesoplasm, and what we just used was an absorbent oil material like it's used in oil spill cleanup. So
And it penetrated the ice?
We let it melt, so this was gone. But we had it in these plastic bags, so outside of this plastic bag there was nothing. But within, we just waited until then summer came, and it melted. And the good thing about oil, it floats, so we just take it away. That being said, we cannot avoid that some of the oil compounds actually were dissolved in the water column and go then out through the bottom. That being said, where we did the experiment, it looks all pristine, but it was actually a coal mine town right there. So the thinking was this potential additional contamination we introduced is not more than the background level of this coal mine. But this is the thing about oil spill experiments. It's very, not a lot of countries allow it. For example, in the US, it's there isn't any possibility to do any experiments like this.
We do experiments, but we do on a really big scale. That's about me.
This will be. We usually wait until we have an oil spill and then study this. Yeah. Also, if you have questions for Ben, so I don't want to.
I don't have questions.
I wanted to know what kinds of. Are you asking, I'm sorry I missed the beginning, and I may want to look at the video if we have access to it later. But are you paying attention to what toxic side effects might be happening as a result of any of this experimentation? I mean, I'm very concerned because when they had the oil rig disaster, the man-made oil volcano in the because of the deepwater horizon in Louisiana, they used these chemical dispersants, which totally polluted the environment and made people really sick. Mm-hmm. And lots of people are covering this back up. the health effects and the top and the any questions are being raised about the toxicity of any of this experimentation, or you know, if it's just the oil is toxic enough as it is, that trying to use microbes to get rid of it sounds like a really great idea to me, which is why I came. And I wanted to know, you know, what kinds of things attention are being paid so that these health side effects don't happen to people and to the environment.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, like one part, what's with the dispersion and what's with the toxic part? And the toxic part, this is actually what the main focus of this project was. So I just described the part where I was involved, where we looked at bioremediation. But the other partners there, we looked at effects for algae, for copepods, for these little creatures, these insects of the sea, for Arctic cod, just like the whole food chain. So that the goal of this project was looking at, if you have this Arctic oil, but how does this disrupt this whole Arctic food chain and effects there? And the second part of this project was a very practical one, saying like, if you have an oil spill, you have several options what to do with the oil spill. So currently, there will be a control center being set up, and they looked at the data, and they looked where the oil is, and the Coast Guard commands it, and they say, should we just skim the oil, try to like vacuum it out? Should we burn it off? Should we use dispersant? Or should we just do nothing? So this is basically the options that are just technically available. In the Arctic, the logistic part then mostly dictates what you can do. Maybe you cannot even access it, you cannot fly it, so you just cannot do anything. But then if it's accessible, then you still have this choice between can you burn it or can you use dispersants. And dispersants are a pretty controversial topic, so it's basically just soap. But their goal is, if you have a bad situation, you can have like two bad things. If you have oil in the water, you can either let it come ashore and potentially contaminate your coastline, or you can add dispersant that would break up the oil in little droplets and then mixing it in the water column, and then it would not come to the shoreline. So the responders have to make the decisions then, where is the oil, where is it going to be, how sensitive is the ecosystem where it's now versus how sensitive is it if it goes to the shore, and make a decision what to do. So the best thing is not to have an oil spill. But I can say, if my opinion is, if the ecosystem at the coastline is very sensitive, usually it seems to be a good idea to try to keep it offshore. Then you have, on a short time scale, you have very toxic effects right in the water column. But you also have all these microbes and bacteria that can eventually take care of it. Versus once it comes to the shore, the oil can be there for decades or even longer. But yeah, it's definitely a topic where a lot of research is going on right now. Because what happened after the Deepwater Horizon incident, they said, we have this dispersant, should we use it? And they're like, well, we don't really have toxicity tests for all the things. And they had to like fast track and do all this research to come up with that. Can we use it? Can we not use it? So it was that people are not prepared for an oil spill at that scale.
Chris, did you guys test the dispersants in any of the mesocosms in the Arctic to see how they perform at cold temperatures and ice?
Mm-hmm. We actually did. So this industry partners, this was kind of like the part where they were most interested in. They said, make some of these tests just with oil, and then also make some of it with a mix it with dispersant and look how this looks. And then they also said, the original idea was burn it, like to do a burn. But then if you burn it off, you create a lot of soot and this black smoke. So then obviously you don't want to do this in an environment like this. So what we did is burning it in a controlled environment and then bringing the residue of this burned oil in there. So we had kind of like all these different oil spill options and looked at this. So far it seems that just the dispersion leads to more mobility of the oil. So the more oil leaks out, but at the end of the season, it doesn't look like a really big difference just visually, but we're still kind of like compiling the data. But it seems to be more oil is then going into the water column. But this should be the purpose of this person, this kind of like having more oil there. Yeah, what we're looking now is kind of how did the bacteria react to this person? Because you have a contamination, you have a pollution, and then you add like another chemical to it. So you want to kind of like make sure that it still keeps your bacteria that actually eat the oil, and you keep them happy.
So did they do that?
It's not yet very clear. So it seems they definitely degraded in all the situations. In some treatments where we had the dispersion, some class of bacteria was just growing way more than in the other treatment, and we don't really know fully what is the functional
thing. You're talking massive increase in surface area for one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the point of dispersion, so having like this good access, like the bacteria can then much easier go to the oil. But as Ben also mentioned, the bacteria, they don't just need food, they also need the nutrients. So it might be that you just run out of nutrients, and then although you have all this oil, the bacteria, they still can't do anything. So this might be a limitation. Yes?
So the whole evening presentation makes it clear that there's a lot of changes and the impact on sort of human behavior will be great, and how we choose to use that, will be determined over this next period of time. But I also see the incredible danger and risk of all of these activities, and I wonder where this conversation sits with the Arctic Council, and how aware and sort of integrated the conversation is with the environmental impacts. Are they doing? I wonder.
Yeah, I would say they're very aware of it. And with the Arctic Council, they're a consensus-based organization. So they don't have a lot of power to enforce things. But what they can do, and what they did a lot, is directing studies and research and compiling literature. So if you go, if you look for some Arctic information, just go on the Arctic Council website and browse all these working groups. They have like a vast amount of data on Arctic pollution assessment or assessment of shipping impacts or impacts of impact of invasive species through shipping or so they really like collect all this data and put them together and try to bring this then in some recommendations to do something, like for example create a big marine protected area where shipping is restricted or something like this.
So do the industry or the shipping companies, the oil companies, the cruise companies, are they also participating in any of these conversations, or do they just, is it a free-for-all, that cruise company, did they just say, it's open, we're just gonna go, or is there sort of a process that happens?
So, first, the industry, they're not part of the Arctic Council, but they also, there are some like observers in the Arctic Council, but this is no like industry representation. There's like NGOs that are there and observing and looking at what's going on. But the shipping industry has to follow regulations that then national or international law is doing. And for example, for the shipping specifically, it's One is national law, and the other one is the international law. So there's this UN organization, the IMO, that's responsible for marine shipping, and they just made new regulations for polar region, the polar code that's going to be in effect starting from next January, I believe, where they say we have some more restriction on how to operate ships. So it's not just about how to discharge waste or anything, but also how structurally sound does a ship need to be. So this is something that's then happening on an international level and then affects the ship operators. So yeah, I guess this flow of information goes somewhere from Arctic Council to then IMO and creating regulations. But yeah, it's a slow process, and the Arctic is really changing rapidly. So
think the law, just the regulations, have to make sure they can catch up with the what's going on. And the, another problem is the Arctic, there's people up there, but it's very sparsely populated. So if you create regulation, can you really enforce it? And so the question of compliance is then the whole different thing. That, if you create a protected area that's close to fisheries, can you really control that?
Sort of following on from yours, and maybe you don't know the answer yet because the meeting hasn't happened, but I'm wondering if there's a, if the dynamic is set up between sort of developed nations and indigenous peoples pushing for economic activity versus protection, or actually if it might be the opposite, and you might have environmental interests in developed nations that are quite far away that are saying protected, and you have native peoples who want economic development. I don't know if you have any sense for that.
That's a very interesting question. I don't know that I can answer this in detail. So the permanent participants or the indigenous people have definitely a strong voice there. And the members are just like the six Arctic nations or seven Arctic nations, if you count Greenland. And then there's like, it must be like four or five different indigenous people representations, organizations that are there. So they are that they're there. But then also, the Arctic isn't homogeneous and the indigenous people don't have one single voice. Like a Sami population may have a very different interest than an Inuit population, which again may have a very different interest from Greenlandic population. For example, Greenland just is kind of like half independent, but they still get money from Denmark and they can become fully independent once their economy works. So they're kind of interested to get their economy growing, and there it's this conflict of preserving their traditional lifestyle that they want, but also developing some of their resources so they can get their economy growing. So it's a very interesting dynamic there. Yeah. Yes?
Have you seen the movie Chasing Ice? Do you know what it is?
I did not.
It's a movie about the Arctic ice and how quickly it's like leaving in frozen because of global warming and climate change. And in it, they talk a lot about the way that the calving of the ice happens because of the warm water getting underneath the ice and stuff, and it caused like huge masses of ice to calve off, like about the size of Manhattan at one point. Have you seen it?
I'm familiar with the story. I haven't looked. I haven't seen the movie, but I'm sure it's much more
dramatic. But I'm just wondering if people like that are at all involved with this kind of discussion, this kind of are being actively involved, people that have been on the front lines to see the disruption of what's happening up in the Arctic because of climate change, and whether there are people that are like that, or like Josh Fox, or people that have been studying things like fracking and stuff, and how an oil spill might affect that kind of calving off of things, and how we can maybe bring more of a global perspective and awareness of these kinds of issues to help people, the other, like the larger public at large, to know about the importance of what the Arctic has to offer and what we can learn from the Arctic.
Mm-hmm. And I think products like Chasing Ice are amazingly effective communication vehicles for, you know, there's people like us who tend to be happy looking at that, you know, that image of ice covered and taken by a satellite, and that's very convincing. And there's probably a much larger part of the public that seeing a very visceral movie about ice melt is much more effective. So I hope the message is actually pretty similar. I think we're both saying that the Arctic is changing, and changing rapidly in sort of a scary way. But I think that we're just using different, you know, methods for doing that. I'd probably be surprised if the NGO or the conservation community is part of those conversations at the Arctic Council, though I don't know, actually. They may very well have a strong voice there. I didn't ask, I think, the other part of your question about any part of those conversations, but I think that we're sort of all part of a continuum of, not necessarily advocacy, but certainly communicating what's going on in a place that isn't near any of us, you know, that's important, so. Mm-hmm. Just pointing out, I can't believe I haven't seen that movie. The book is great, isn't it? I think we showed it probably, think of it too. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think I would add to that that it's also, you know, it's really the time where everybody that has experience with this or scientists that have been up, they really make their, communicate their observations to policymaker and there. So like that, I think traditionally maybe scientists have thought more like, I just do my science and publish my results and that's it. But I think now that we have to be more making a connection with our decision makers and educating them, engaging with them to that we all can kind of like try to understand what's happening and what the consequences are.
So your point about learning from the architect, I mean, I think that is what we want to do, right? I mean, it's only been in the last 5 or 10 years that there's been a real push to study the architect from a scientific perspective or from an observational perspective, or like Jason Knight's. So there is now, and that's really, there's been many more financial resources put into supporting research, like the two of us have done and others at Bigelow and elsewhere, to try to now learn before it changes and understand, you know, what we can learn from it. And I think we don't have a lot of those questions. It's totally different, as I pointed out, from the Antarctic and totally different from other areas. It's a really unique spot. So I think the community is working hard to learn while we can. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you mostly studied like microorganisms, but you said like there are more organisms growing through the longer period and everything, during the summer, warmer months and everything. Do you know, like, has there been more like thriving of like fish or like other like whales, and like have they been migrating towards there, or have they been like growing in population in there or anything like that?
It's a great question. I don't know, I'll be honest, I don't know the answer to that. I think, do you have a sense through indigenous catches? I mean, I think there isn't a very developed fishery, a commercial fishery in much of the Arctic. Because of the ice cover, it's a tough place to run a commercial fishery. So much of the productivity that comes into Dutch Harbor and in Alaska is in the Gulf of Alaska, and not up in the Arctic Circle. And much of even what's up there, I mean, for example, the native communities around Barrow and in the Canadian Arctic are not going hundreds of miles, you know, into the ice cover Arctic to study or to collect fish and capture those things. I think it's mostly coastal. So the answer to that, I don't know. You would imagine that you would see those changes. You know, just like in the Gulf of Maine, we've seen changes in the productivity at the bottom of the food web, and we expect those to filter up to the upper food web. I think it's the same is true there, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm not aware of really documented changes in the upper water, upper pool.
Yeah, but the thought there is like, we mentioned this really deadliest catch area just below the Arctic Circle. The thought, maybe if it warms, then all this productive area goes up there, and then it's really a productive fishery. Maybe
right, it's like the fishery moving north.
Right. Or the other thing is the European Arctic is pretty different, as you saw on Ben's slide. The European, Russian Arctic doesn't have that much ice, so there is a lot of fisheries on the kind of like Norwegian-Russian border, the Barents Sea, and there is also that question like who has the fish there. So it's all like the Norwegian. I think it migrated from Russia to the Norwegians. Also, and the Norwegians have more to catch there because of migration, or they migrate back. So this is, in terms of fisheries, there's definitely going to be a lot of changes that are just due to warming. For more bigger, like marine mammals or polar bears, there is definitely changes that have been noticed. Not all in the same direction. Definitely not. Polar bears have usually a harder life. But I just heard recently that the polar bear population on the Russian side of the Bering Sea, of the Bering Strait, they actually are thriving. So they are increasing, while other polar populations are suffering. But these animals that depend on ice, they will definitely change. So this is are going to be very impactful. And the other thing about whales, this part of timing that you mentioned in terms of the algae grow, and then the copepods come, and then finally the whales actually eat this. So if this timing is all of a sudden off, then the whole migration of the whale come all the way up there, but then the food may not be there anymore. So then it may really be also detrimental.
Maybe one more question?
Yeah.
I have a specific interest in the Cree and Inuit of the James Bay ecosystem, and I'm wondering if that's also possibly included in this Arctic culture at all, or how far south does the Arctic extend to?
Where is James Bay?
That
within the Arctic Circle, I assume that's the boundary they use. I don't know. I'm not familiar with the local geography. Is it? Do you know if that's within the Arctic Circle?
I don't know.
Yeah.
But that's the territory boundary that it would be. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'll go research that.
But then even the Arctic, like where is the Arctic? This is depending on the organization or the law. Well, yeah, there's slightly different definitions of the Arctic. Some say everything just above the Arctic Circle is Arctic. Others say where you have like no freeze anymore, where you have like a certain temperature gradient. So depending on the definition you use, you can have the Arctic extending all the way to the Aleutian Islands or within there. So this is then relevant if you, for example, have a regulation like this polar code for shipping. This goes pretty much beyond the Arctic Circle just because of the definition this different organizations use.
Well, thank you, guys.
Thank you.